This conference will now be recorded.
And I humbly thank TTU Academy very much for inviting me once again for another interactive and wonderful session that we are going to have today. Thank you for joining us, all the doctors and nurses out there. We are always happy to help you with regards to OET examination and all other aspects also and ambiguities that you have. As I told you earlier, that today's session is going to be a very influential and beneficial session when it comes to OET writing. Whenever we interact with you people, you always ask us some questions. And it is only through those questions that we come to know that what we can provide to you, what you lack in, and which are the places in which you make mistakes and you fail the OET. So we always try to make a very thorough research at TTU Academy to come up with those things that have been taken before by nobody and at nowhere, and which are very, very influential, beneficial, and important. Rather, I should say that are very, very thankful, significant for OET examination. So the topic that we are going to take today is regarding punctuation marks. And punctuation marks indeed play a very vital role when it comes to OET writing special. Of course, whenever we speak, we take pauses, we take stops, wherever we find them necessary. In the same manner as you would be hearing me or listening to me, I am taking proper punctuations wherever they are required. I slow down my voice wherever it is required, and I try to make all sorts of possibilities in emphasizing my words upon. But whenever it comes to writing, in writing, there is no voice incorporated. So in writing, whenever we have to show emphasis upon something, we try to and we tend to take help with punctuation marks. So in today's class, we would exclusively be discussing punctuation marks. Begin forth. So what will we learn today? Today we will learn basic punctuation marks, and all of us know as to what basic punctuation marks are. Some basic punctuation marks are exclamation marks, but exclamation marks are not used in OET. Still, I thought that we will discuss a little from exclamation marks just to enhance our knowledge. Other punctuation marks are commas, which are of very greater significance in OET. Others are apostrophe, semicolon, the colon, and period. Now, what is period? A period is a full stop. But in American English, we call the full stop as a period. And in British English, we call it as a full stop. So if somebody says to you that what is a period, you can say that a period is a dot-like symbol to finish a sentence or to provide abbreviations. It is called as a period in American English, and it is called as a full stop in the British English. So this knowledge is important if somebody asks to us. Coming next, let us discuss the exclamation marks. Exclamation marks are the marks that are used to induce upon anger, command, amazement, pain, happiness, sudden emotions, etc., etc. For example, I'm really excited about my new job. Here, in the first sentence, there is no emotion involved. But in the second sentence, I'm really excited about my new job! Exclamation mark. This sentence shows some sort of emotions incorporated, or you can say associated with the sentence. And those emotions are excitement and happiness. Similarly, if you come late, you are fired! An exclamation mark. This shows that the person who is making this statement is angry. John, don't play with the food! Exclamation mark. Here, the exclamation mark tries to show that there is a strict command being given. Ouch, you hit me. Again, there are exclamation marks which are trying to induce upon pain. Wow, what a beautiful house. This is amazement. Here, exclamation marks are showing amazement. So exclamation marks are used to show emotions, and emotions like excitement, happiness, anger, commands, pain, and amazement. Now let us come to commas. Most of us often get confused with the commas. We often do not know where to place commas. And commas are the first thing in punctuation marks that the OET people are really trying to look forward in your letters. Because any one of us can write a letter. What we cannot do is that we fail to put connectors, I mean the proper connectors, and we do not know where to put proper punctuation marks. And amongst all those punctuation marks, we are often confused regarding the commas. So in today's class, I will try to clarify you completely everything related to commas. So always put a comma after a connector. Now, which connectors? Let us see. So you have to put a comma after these connectors. Although, therefore, subsequently, consequently, which resulted in, for which, because of, in order to, followed by, following. So whenever you use these connectors in your OET writing, always try to put a comma after the connector. Please make this clear in your brains that you have to place a comma after these connectors, because there are some connectors in which comma is placed before them. I'm repeating my words. There are some connectors in which the comma is placed before the connector. But in these connectors given on your screens, what you have to do is that you try to use connectors, commas after these connectors. In the meantime, please take a look at these connectors, and if you have a notebook by your sides, you can make short notes also.
Will now be recorded.
So I assume that you would be you would be able to understand that whenever we have these connectors, although, therefore, subsequently, however, which resulted in, always place a comma after these connectors. Now, I told you that there are some connectors before which we have to place a comma, before which. In these connectors, you have to place a comma after them. So, these are the connectors in which it is necessary that you place a comma before them. And these are fanboys. We have often discussed these in most of our sessions. So whenever you are placing a connector amongst these fanboys, please try to put a comma before them. And whenever you have these connectors, always try to put a comma after these connectors. In these connectors, always place a comma before these connectors. Now let us understand clauses. So these are clauses. A clause or a phrase is a collection of words. Now on your screens, I have listed out some clauses. Can somebody out of you unmute yourselves and tell me as to which of these clauses are dependent and which of these are independent. I want to tell you that dependent clauses are those clauses which require more information to clarify themselves, and independent clauses are complete in themselves. So I request one of you to unmute yourself and tell me as to which of these clauses are dependent and which ones are independent.
When the drugs were administered and on admission, Mr. Steve, these are the dependent ones.
These are the
dependent.
And independent is the when rest is on. With rest is on, it's the independent.
Okay, so can you tell me that after the patient was discharged, what clause is this, dependent or independent?
It's dependent. Dependent. It's dependent.
Dependent.
Okay. Dr. Zafran and Sanjita Parveen says that after the patient was discharged is dependent clause because we require more information. What happened after that? After the patient was discharged, then what? What happened then? So this is a dependent clause. It requires more information. We dressed his wounds. This is independent clause. No more information is required. We dressed his wounds is complete. Similarly, when the drugs were administered, this is dependent clause. When the drugs were administered, then what? Then what happened? So we want more information. That what happened after that? The nurse was waiting outside. This is independent clause. The nurse was waiting outside is independent clause. On admission, Mr. Steve, what? What did he do? So again, this is dependent clause. So with this notion, I assume that you must have understood as to what clauses are and what are dependent and independent clauses are. So clauses are just a collection of words, but there are two types of clauses, dependent and independent. And the usage of comma depends only on these two type of clauses. So now can I make sure that all of you have understood as to what dependent and independent clauses are? If there is a confusion, please write in the chat windows. If dependent and independent clauses are clear, please write why in the chat windows so that I can proceed ahead. Okay, fine. So it seems that dependent and independent clauses are clear to all of you. So I can proceed ahead. Now let us see. Whenever there is a dependent clause and an independent clause combined together, we have to place the comma in between. I will show you with an example. If you study more, is a dependent clause. If you study more, then what? Then what will happen? So if you study more is a dependent clause. It requires more information. You will get good marks is independent clause. You will get good marks is independent clause. So whenever we have a dependent clause and an independent clause, we place a comma in between them always. Always. So whenever we have a dependent clause, like in this example, if you study more is a dependent clause, you will get good marks is an independent clause. So dependent clause, independent clause, there should be a comma in between. Let us see more examples. Unless you finish your lunch, unless you finish your lunch is a dependent clause. Unless you finish your lunch, then what? You can't have the cake. You can't have the cake. So you can't have the cake is independent. So we have a dependent clause and an independent clause. And whenever we have dependent and independent, we place a comma in between. And this is how we can memorize this D, comma I. Now, if we have an independent clause and a dependent clause, that is vice versa, no comma in between. Example, I was so happy when I saw her. So when I was so happy is independent. I was so happy is independent. When I saw her is dependent. When I saw her, then what? So it requires more information. So whenever you have independent first and dependent later, no comma in between. Another example, my children ate breakfast while I read the newspaper. So again, this is independent and dependent, and there is no comma in between. And please do not get confused with both of these. I will give you a trick to memorize it. And the trick is Manu's mantra. Whenever you have independent and independent, always put a comma in between. Whenever you have a dependent clause and independent clause, comma in between. But whenever you have ID, whenever you have ID, no comma. In all the cases, comma. In ID, no comma. So just memorize it by your heart. Whenever you have II, DI, DD, place a comma in between. But whenever you have ID, no comma in between. Whenever you have ID, no comma in between. Let us look at our sentences once again. If you have any doubts, please feel free to ask, or else you will lose your marks. This is the correct and the high time to learn something. This is an opportunity. So if you have any doubts, please ask. If you have to ask any questions, you can unmute yourself and you can ask. This is a platform where we can interact with each other freely. And I always promote interaction during our sessions. So if you have any confusion or a problem or an ambiguity during this session, please feel free to ask. So Manu's mantra clarifies it all in just one go. That whenever you have ID, no comma, and whenever you have whatever, always a comma in between. Again, whenever we have relative clauses, no comma. For example, that is the doctor who won the Nobel Prize in medicine this year. So we are relating the doctor with something. These are relative clauses. These clauses are relative clauses where both the clauses are related to each other. They are trying to give meaning to each other. So in the first clause, we are talking about a doctor. And in the second part of the sentence, also we are talking about the same doctor. So these both are related. And whenever you have relative clauses, no comma in between. In ID, no comma, and in relative clauses, no comma. This is the hospital where I underwent the surgery. She is the patient who was diagnosed with PCOS yesterday. So you often write these sentences in your OET letter. Do not place a comma in between or you will lose marks. Here are some cells which have been affected. These are relative clauses. They are related to each other. He is the doctor that the patient saw today. He is the doctor that the patient saw today. Now you will say that, sir, why aren't these clauses relative clauses? You will say that why aren't these clauses relative relative clauses? These are not relative clauses. These are different clauses. If you study more, you will get good marks. Both the clauses are not related to each other, but these clauses are related to each other. The second clause is talking about the first clause, and both are interconnected. Now we have a series of case notes, and can you present this case note in one sentence without full stops using connectors and commas? Using connectors and commas. If you can do so, please write the answers in the chat window. Can you paraphrase this pieces of case note in one single sentence? Okay, Dr. Aaron, your answer is correct, but the patient did not present with vomiting and diarrhea. Vomiting and diarrhea took place 1 hour later. Your answer says that the patient presented with severe headache, vomiting and diarrhea. No, the patient presented only with severe headache. Diarrhea and vomiting took place later. This is how you lose marks in OET writing. This is how you lose marks and you fail. Can somebody else give the correct answer? If not, then I will present my answer to you. And this is how the correct answer looks. Okay, Sanjida, we are waiting for you. Let us wait for other answers. Okay, Sanjida, your answers is incomplete. This is how the correct answer looks like. The patient first presented with a severe headache, which was followed by vomiting and diarrhea 1 hour later. This is how the correct answer looks like. The patient presented with severe headache, which was followed by vomiting and diarrhea 1 hour later. So this is the art of paraphrasing case notes, and my last session was exclusively upon all of this. This is where you lose your marks. Comma is also placed to enclose unnecessary information. This book, first published in 1956, is still useful for OET. Now, first published in 1956 is unnecessary. Yes, Shreyosi, your answer is very correct. Very nicely given answer. Shreyosi Saha, your answer is also very correct. Let me read your answer for all of you. After presenting with severe headache, the patient suffered with vomiting and diarrhea 1 hour later. Very good. Your answer is also very correct. So I was telling you that we enclose unnecessary information in commas. Commas are also used to emphasize dates and places like this on your screens. This is how commas are also used. So whenever you write your address in the letter, in the OET letter, you're writing the address of the doctor to whom you're writing, and the date, always try to place proper commas. And this is how it is done. Also, comma is also placed after time phrases. Like on admission, comma, Mr. Paul was complaining of unbearable pain in his abdomen. So after time phrases, you always have to place commas. To date, Mehnaz has seen the speech therapist 3 times. So we placed a comma after to date. Commas are also used to separate dose from the name of the medication. And this is how it is done. Mr. Paul is prescribed metformin, comma, a 2 mg tablet, and lactulose, comma, 50 milligram syrup. In the morning. Commas are also placed after relationships and names, like Mr. Jack's wife, comma, Anne, comma, was shown how to change the dressing on the wound site. Al Mooney, comma, cardiologist, comma, is here. So we always place a comma after names and relationships. Al Mooney, comma, cardiologist. Jason, comma, can you bring me the reports? Question mark. Commas are also placed after introducer words like well, no, yes, unfortunately, and friendly. So these are the very intricate usages of commas that we often confuse in. Commas are always used after salutations also, like dear sir, dear madam, dear doctor. And they are always placed after closings like this, yours sincerely. And you have to place a comma after that. Yours faithfully, comma. Yours truly, comma. So commas are always placed after salutations and after closings also. So did you see how many uses of commas we saw in this lecture today? Commas are also used to replace brackets and dashes in case notes. So those of you who have a confusion that whether we can use brackets and dashes in OET letter, yes, we can do it. The answer is yes, you can make use of brackets and dashes, or you can say hyphens in your OET letter like this. Mrs. Wang is prescribed amoxicillin, bracket 1 gram twice daily, and omeprazole, comma 20 mg twice daily. This is how you can do it. Also, Mrs. Wang is prescribed amoxicillin, comma 1 gram twice daily, and omeprazole, comma 20 milligrams daily. This is also correct. Mr. Eric's current medication, dash, warfarin and pulmicort, dash, need review at his next consultation. So this is how you write it. You can make use of commas and colons. At his next consultation, comma, Mr. Eric needs a review of his current medications, colon, warfarin and Pulmicort. So we replaced the dashes of the case note by commas here. So you can use brackets in OET letter, but avoid using dashes and hyphens. Those are in the case notes. You replace the dashes and hyphens by commas, or you can use brackets. Using brackets and commas is fine with OET letters. Okay. Now let us come to apostrophe. We often have confusion regarding apostrophes. So Thomas book and Thomas's book, these both are correct. Many a times we are told that the names which end in S, we place only apostrophe after them. So both are correct. Whether you place an apostrophe or you place an apostrophe and S, both are correct. So the names of people which end in S, so you can use both, even apostrophe or apostrophe S. Boss's office and boss's office, both are correct. But here, there is one thing that you have to pay attention towards, that Thomas and boss are singular. They are one person. Thomas and boss are one person. But what happens in this case? Girls coach and girls coach. So girls are a plural subject. Girls are plural. So always with a plural subject, place only an apostrophe, not an apostrophe S. Similarly, 7 years experience, 7 years experience. So the first one is correct and the second one is incorrect. So whenever we have a singular subject, we can use both apostrophe or apostrophe S. But whenever we have a plural subject, we use only an apostrophe and not an apostrophe S. Apostrophes are also used to mark contractions, like I'm a doctor. This means I am a doctor. He'd never take medications. He would never take medications. He doesn't show a change in his blood glucose levels. So doesn't, pay attention towards the spelling of doesn't. D-O-E-S-N apostrophe T is correct, but D-O-E-S apostrophe N-T is incorrect. So always try to place the correct spelling. Please take a look at your screens and make sure that you avoid these mistakes. Also, apostrophes are also used to mark possessions. Like this book is hers. The pen is yours. Its skin is very smooth. So did you see in the first three sentences, we haven't used an apostrophe. And why haven't we done it? It is because of this reason, that its skin means skin of somebody. But when we say it apostrophe S, it means it is a skin. So did you see how difference is created just with an apostrophe? To clarify more, I have given it here. The first its means possession, but the second its means it has or it is. It is time to diagnose the patient. It's time. Just one apostrophe can make a number of differences. So, it has been a while since the patient suffered stroke. Now, let us come to semicolon. Semicolon is always used between two independent clauses. Please make sure that you place a semicolon between two independent clauses. And these are the examples. I went to see a movie with my wife. I thought it was amazing. She thought it was terrible. Now all these clauses are independent clauses. All these clauses are independent clauses. So how will we use punctuation marks with these? It is how that we do it. I thought it was amazing, comma, but she thought it was terrible. Here we placed a comma before but, because but is amongst the fanboys. And this is another way how we can write it. I thought it was amazing, semicolon, she thought it was terrible. So these are two independent clauses. And when it with independent clauses, what we do is that we always place a semicolon in between. So whenever you have two independent clauses, please make sure that you have put an put a semicolon in between. Always put a semicolon before these connectors. Therefore, however, in addition, in fact, consequently, gradually, moreover, followed by, which resulted in. So you always place a semicolon before these connectors. Always use a comma after these connectors, but always use a comma before fanboys. This information you can only obtain at Teach Academy and nowhere else. This is an example in front of you. Montana's annual rainfall is below average. Semicolon, moreover, temperatures are warmer. Let us come to colons now. Colon is used to introduce a list. For example, the restro of menu offers a variety of choices. Colon, soup, sandwiches, and burgers. Mr. Tanaka will need a diet rich in colon, vitamins, irons, and proteins. But do not use a colon after like, are, including, such as. For example, never use a colon after these. For example, there are many kinds of dogs like. So we have placed a colon. This is wrong. There are three men in the party, including colon, Jeff and Haynes. This is wrong. Now let us come to full stop, or you can call it as a period. We place a full stop when the abbreviation ends in the same letter as that of the word. For example, Mr. So the abbreviation of Mr. is MR, and it ends in R, and Mr. also ends in R. So we will not use a period or full stop after Mr. Next example, Miss. Do not use a full stop after MS dot, no, only MS. Doctor, DR, no dot, because both the abbreviation and the word end in the same letter. So this is one thing that nobody will share with you, but we at Teach Academy try to imbibe into your brains all sorts of information pertaining to OET examinations. Here, don't use a full stop. Don't use a full stop, but always use a full stop when the abbreviation doesn't end with the same length. For example, professor and captain. So this was all about punctuation marks in today's session. And if you missed out something, you can watch this session on our YouTube channel with the same name. Any sort of queries are invited. Till then, I wind up this session and we'll see each other on the next turn. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, Manoj sir, for a very, very important and a very informative session, like always. Thank you. And guys, I hope you've learned something from this session. It's actually quite important that we pay attention to basic grammar rules on the OET writing, because the problem is that lots of people, they just concentrate on what exactly is the history that we are to include, what exactly is the history that we are to exclude. And then they start to make it extremely medical, talking about things which are quite complicated. And often, even as doctors and nurses, opinions vary as to which history is relevant to the patient and which is not. That's the difficult part. But as long as you've got good English and you're paying attention to grammar rules and you're putting the right full stops and you're putting the right commas, the examiner is already going to get a very good impression out of your letter, and those difficult points won't matter. I keep repeating this again and again, guys. You can't pass the OET writing without paying attention to basic grammar, because that's the level one and level two. If you're talking about level five and level six and talking about very, very complicated history points, that's not going to make much of a difference if you fail at level one and two. So extremely important that everyone understands that the OET writing is essentially an English exam. And if your English is bad, then you're going to fail. The other things won't matter anymore. So thank you, Manoj sir, for a very, very important and informational session, like always. We will be uploading this on YouTube. So make sure that you're subscribed to our channel, which is by the same name of Teach Your Academy. Guys, one quick thing that I just wanted to say, lots of people, they made their writing check and speaking checks at the very last moment with Teach Your. So they booked it very, very close to the exam. And what ended up happening is that we were conducting speaking sessions and writing sessions each day. Now, that's not an ideal situation. Because what we want with Teach Your is that when we're offering you the bulk speaking check or the bulk writing check, we give you feedback after each session and we give you study material after each session, which we want you to go through and we want you to memorize before going on to the next one, because we want to build up on your concepts and we want to build up on your writing skills. So if your exam is about a month away, we would suggest booking your writing and speaking check now, so that then you can get a decent amount of time in between those five sessions where you can build up on your levels. Otherwise, what will happen is that you'll keep on making the same mistake on each session and not really building up, and that's going to affect your confidence as well. So if you're interested in our writing check and our speaking check, please go to our website, which is by the name of www.teachyouracademy.com, and you should be able to book your writing and speaking checks. If you're someone who wants to opt for like three speaking checks and two writing checks, you can do that. Just get in touch with us before, and then we can give you a customized plan. And we can offer you three speaking checks or two, or whatever you want to do. We're completely customized. So just make sure that you get in touch with us as soon as possible if your exam is soon, because we obviously want you to build up each time that you conduct a writing or a speaking check with us. You can contact Dr. Prashant on the number provided on the screen, and he'll be happy to answer all of your questions. All right, guys, we're going to wrap up today's session. Just keep studying, keep revising, keep practicing, and hopefully you should be having a very, very successful OET journey pretty soon. Good luck.